This is sort of, you know, an overview of this different enrichment analysis methods, and I'm not going to go into that again because George explained it in some details. But so the sort of thing that I want to focus, rather than focusing on different statistical methods for doing enrichment analysis, I kind of want to put a little bit of emphasis on the databases, right? So there are two components to it, doing enrichment analysis. So, you know, obviously you have to have your input data, which is represented by this sort of generic heat map here, can be gene expression, can be metabolites, can be proteomics data. But what you also need, you need some kind of database, right? So, or databases. This can be pathways, this can be some arbitrary, you know, defined groups of metabolites or genes, you know, as long as they are sort of, you know, biologically relevant or biologically related in some sort of, you know, way that is meaningful for you. So, for example, it can be a group of again, metabolites or genes, depending on what you're studying, that are known to be upregulated in a certain type of cancer versus normal tissues, as an example. So as long as they're meaningful from the sort of, you know, statistical standpoint, it doesn't matter what kind of databases you use. But it is obviously very important for practical outcomes. So that's what I want to emphasize. This is sort of, you know, another view of this sort of 2x2 table. So I think in the interest of time, I will just sort of, you know, keep moving forward. And so the sort of, you know, I think to emphasize one sort of, you know, message that George sort of, you know, gave to you. There are over-representation analysis methods, and there are what is called functional class scoring methods. And so there are representations of both of these methods for, or implementations rather, both of these methods for metabolomics. Okay, this is a tool from the same group that developed human HMDB, human metabolome database. David Wishart's group in at the University of Alberta, and this tool is called MSEA. So the analogy here is with very well-known GSEA program, and as a matter of fact, it has a couple of different three different analysis approaches. One is over-representation analysis, which is using a variation of Fisher's exact test. And there is also something that is analogous to this functional scoring, where you take your entire ranked list of metabolites. I'll be honest with you, I had very mixed results, and I have seen very mixed results with this specific tool with various metabolomics studies. So there are several problems that I will talk to you about specifically. One, it is really hard to get statistically significant results. And if you think about this, when you're doing, when you're analyzing gene expression, you may have 20,000 genes on your microarray. And even after you have ranked them for significance, you can still have several hundred, you know, maybe a couple of thousand quote-unquote significant genes. So nobody knows what to do with that sort of information. There's absolutely no way that you can go and follow up on this, right? So there is so some methods are needed to kind of, you know, prioritize this and, you know, put them into biological pathways. With metabolites, you're starting with a much smaller number, which sort of, you know, will make sense. I mean, it's still a lot, but it's very difficult to have this sort of, you know, statistically significant result. Okay, another tool that is using also variation of Fisher's exact test, which is sort of, you know, becoming very popular by the Spanish group. It is called MBROL, and I believe they published an updated version of that. So there is a newer publication, but at least it will give you some sort of example. There are several other tools for doing metabolite enrichment analysis type, but I think, you know, these two are probably the most mature that are out there that are, you know, if you are really interested. So, okay, so let me just sort of, you know, go back to what you can do with Medscape. What you can take your metabolites and you can map them and you can build this metabolic networks, right? But if you are asking a question, which of this, what Medscape currently at least will not, this version that I talked about will not do, it will not tell you that this pathway is more sort of ranked higher than this pathway and so on and so forth, right? These tools attempt to rank your pathways, statistically rank your pathways. And if that's the information that you're after, I would recommend trying one of these two tools. I mean, we've tried here some others, and I think that, you know, these are, like I said, probably more mature one, right? So let me talk to you about issues with metabolite enrichment analysis. I started talking about this. I already said, you know, a little bit about lower statistical power. I mean, the issue that we have not talked about much during this workshop is issue of IDs, okay? So when you're doing this mapping, you start either with a compound name or some kind of compound identifier, right? With genes, it's relatively straightforward nowadays, right? So as long as you have gene symbol or untrained gene ID, you're good to go with almost any program for doing almost anything. With metabolites, well, I mean, I know there are some chemists in the audience, right? So if I say that there is no single standard compound identifier, you know, if you talk to a chemist, chemists get upset. I mean, they say, what do you mean there is no single compound identifier? What about Cas number? And, you know, compounds are very well defined. Well, Not to a biologist, no, they're not, okay? So all these pathway databases and, you know, all this sort of, you know, business about biological role of compounds, if you go to a KEG database, I mean, they may not have what is like, you know, to a chemist, the most sort of standard logical chemical name. They may not have this name, okay? They may have hundreds of other names that are much more familiar to biologists, right? But they may not have a systematic chemical name. So in other words, it's kind of a mess. So it's very difficult to match these compound identifiers, okay? This is one sort of, you know, serious issue with any kind of pathway mapping or, you know, pathway enrichment analysis, right? So there are various sort of, you know, there are tons of different databases for doing gene set enrichment analysis. For metabolites, there are not so many. I mean, there are pathways and, you know, you can, if you're really creative, you can sort of, you know, map metabolites to enzymes and then, you know, enzymes to genes, and genes are mapped to gene ontology categories. So, you know, through this, you can sort of map metabolites to go categories, which we have done, and so did many other people. But, you know, that's about it for metabolites. And so, I mean, that information is also somewhat limited, which all of this sort of, you know, are adding up, creating sort of various constraints and limiting the usability of this whole, like, you know, pathway enrichment, pathway analysis methods. Okay, so this was an interesting paper and an interesting tool, despite the funny name. I understand that it is the name of a small fish. So I'm not exactly sure why the program was called that. So the idea here is, I mean, it's sort of a variation of enrichment analysis tool. But in this case, in this case, what, you know, they suggest doing essentially, so it attempts to incorporate the unknown, this unknown compounds or features into analysis. Okay, so what they're doing here, they're basically taking all the, you know, pathway information, all the compounds that are contained in metabolic pathways, and they essentially, you know, take a list of these and they convert them to features, okay? They take a set of molecular weights. And then they're doing this enrichment analysis in feature space rather than in a compound space, okay? And I've heard that people used it and got some good results. I haven't used it quite as much because with our untargeted data, we attempt to identify compounds. And those that, you know, we have identified, it seems a little bit counterintuitive to throw away that information and start with a completely unannotated list of features. Although maybe we should just, you know, give it another thought and another try. So I haven't used it quite as much. So, I haven't used it, although I heard, you know, that people have used it. Okay. So a few words about data integration. These are all like, you know, all this sort of, you know, this is the quest, like, you know, this holy grail, but these are all different layers we want to integrate and incorporate information from all these different omics and so on and so forth. Very crowded slide, but when you're thinking about this integration, and there was a question after the first talk, just before the break, I think, you know, some very basic questions to consider and to think about. And I mean, this is obviously, you know, does not begin to address sort of methodological side of how you integrate different omics data, but as, you know, several people alluded to, this is really the state of the art. Okay, so things to consider. First of all, does it make sense to integrate the data? Are you doing metabolomics in tissue or biofluid? Are you doing for your expression profiling or proteomics or whatever omics you're doing on the same tissue or, you know, same biofluid? Does it make sense biologically? The other consideration is time scale. I mean, are the changes that you expect to see in metabolome, proteome, you know, are they happening on the same time scale? How do you want to sort of, you know, design your experiment so the data would be, at least in theory, you would be able to sort of integrate. So you would see sort of, you know, some meaningful correlations or trends in your data and so on and so forth, right? These issues here with the missing data. I mean, with gene expression, it is less of an issue. When you're dealing with sort of, you know, different omics, you have different sort of, you know, issues with missing data, and you have to sort of, you know, handle it across your sort of, you know, different layers, and it becomes a very serious problem, right? Same is true for heterogeneity to some extent, you know, what I said about different time scales and so on and so forth. And I kind of, you know, touched on low statistical power because, you know, we're measuring a relatively small number of metabolites. So, right. So speaking of low statistical power, this is sort of, you know, this applies again to all of the sort of, you know, pathway mapping and enrichment analysis technique. It's sort of useful to have a reality check in terms of, like, you know, what am I going to see? I mean, the thing to keep in mind that with the exception of this program MummyChalk that I've mentioned, all the other programs that we talked about, they assume that, you know, the input are known compounds, right? And realistically, with, you know, so these are, like, you know, for at least, you know, three most popular platforms that are out there. I mean, well, perhaps it's a little bit conservative, but these are the, that's the number of known metabolites that we are going to see, right? Okay? And this is, like, you know, this is not a whole lot, right? So, then, you know, all the methods that, you know, for pathway mapping that I've described so far, all of them are knowledge-based, right? So essentially, you know, if Chuck mentioned that, and, you know, so how are we going to, I mean, and I often get that question, how are we going, are you going to discover any new information if you're not sort of, you're limiting yourself to novel pathway? So I'm trying to sort of, you know, build up all that information to sort of, you know, motivation for sort of doing something and going beyond pathways, right? And so I'm going to just show you the slide, it's not that bad as I thought. So it sort of, you know, embodies everything that is sort of, you know, the limitations of the pathway mapping, essentially, okay? So in this case, so what I'm showing you the lipid network, okay? And so the lipidomics platform that, you know, we have here and, you know, many other sort of, you know, cores have, and, you know, many other people have, you can detect several hundreds in plasma. You can detect, like, you know, 500, 600, 700 different lipids, right? So if you take this and if you go and try to map them, in this case, you know, I mapped it in Medscape, what you're going to see is, I think what, you know, I can sort of only adequately describe it as a class level network, right? So a single dot here corresponds to another class in, of sphingomyelins, right? So TM can tell you how many we can, or, you know, Tanu can tell you how many of the individual lipids we see. So this really doesn't do anybody any good, right? So I guess, you know, what I'm trying to say is that the coverage of this pathway databases is very limited, okay? Primary metabolism is covered pretty well. Secondary metabolism is not covered nearly as well, if you look at this. Lipid metabolism covered very poorly, right? And that's basically the, you know, that's basically the bottom line, right? And so the resolution is not anywhere near where, you know, you need, we need it to be in order to be sort of useful and give us the useful information, right? So the question becomes, what can we do and how can we go beyond that? And, you know, what can we do? Okay, so one sort of little nice tool that I'm going to mention to you that we developed here, actually, you know, I tried to stress that all these pathway databases are really sort of, you know, contain really highly curated and high quality data. And people spend many, I mean, people with expertise and knowledge have spent many, many hours curating this. And the question that we asked, we said, okay, well, you know, there is a wealth of information about biological roles of metabolites in published literature. Can we leverage that somehow? Okay? And so we developed this automated pipeline, which we call Metab2Mesh, where essentially we take entire PubChem database. And so, you know, let me sort of, you know, give you the scale here. So, so far we were talking about, so the database, for example, you know, KEG, like, or, you know, human metabolic pathway database contains something in the order of 2,000 metabolites, okay? On the other hand, here we're starting with, you know, I don't know how big PubChem is nowadays, several million? Okay, right. So we're starting with a huge database. Well, it contains not only endogenous compounds, it contains all kinds of things, and it's pretty redundant, but nonetheless, we start with a very large database, and we start with a PubMed here, okay? And so we then basically use the information to map the articles to PubChem compounds, and I'm sort of, you know, skipping the details of the method, but so you get, you know, you can map them to each other, but, you know, you get a lot of sort of, you know, spurious matches there. And in order to kind of, you know, make it a little bit more precise, we did a statistical test to find the most significant associations between compounds and published articles. And so these are the collaborators who were involved in doing this work. Maureen Sartor, Alex Aid, and Zach Wright, and there is a web-based sort of interface for looking at this data, and you can search it sort of, you know, by one. I'm showing one compound here, cyclic AMP, and these are various sort of, you know, mesh terms, which you probably cannot read, but the important thing is that there is a link here that will take you directly to actually PubMed, and allows you to look at the articles that sort of, you know, support this connection. And on the next slide, I'm just going to show you what we, what you can do with this sort of information, right? So this is another little tool, CytoScape-based tool that we developed. And so here is a network. Here is a pretty large network of metabolites, and this is actually just an example from, you know, some published study. But what you can do here is you can, if you select all this sort of, you know, go through this menu and choose to sort of annotate the network, here it is displaying the mesh, mesh a subset of this sort of. I should have explained that. I don't know if everybody knows what mesh is. Medical subject headings that the National Library of Medicine uses to annotate the all published biomedical literature. Okay, and it's sort of a hierarchical structure, and it includes many sort of important and relevant biological categories. And here we are looking at specifically at diseases. And in this example, I have neoplasms, and I can sort of, as I navigate down this tree, if I select a particular term like brain neoplasm here, the nodes that have been associated with this term in the network get selected, right? And then what I can do, I can just go and right-click on the node, like, here, 12 compounds have been associated with brain neoplasms. And I can actually display the articles that, link this compound to this particular disease. So it's just sort of another way to, this is completely automated. This is not curated at all. So, this is just sort of, a way to sort of, generate this additional annotations. So this is sort of a side story, but it doesn't sort of address the main problem, right? So, you can try and generate more annotations, but what do you do about, how do we deal with the bulk of data? So if you're getting in your untargeted study, you're getting maybe 3,000 features and they're only 10% of these compounds are known, you don't want to throw away all that information, right? And people have tried different approaches for doing that. And so we know that among these features, some of these features are actually, highly correlated with each other, right? And people have used various sort of, correlation analysis techniques for analyzing gene expression data. And so I guess, why not apply the same thing to metabolites, right? So the idea is essentially that the compounds that are sort of, functionally related or somehow related, they will, they will not change. If they are changing in a coordinated fashion, they may be functionally related. That's sort of, what we're trying to get at. And the first sort of, most, intuitive thing to do, and you have seen this in these heat maps, to run, some simple sort of correlation analysis such as Pearson's correlation. But if you even if you take one of these heat maps, you can apply certain threshold. You can say that, I'm only going to look at the correlations that are, above certain threshold. And then, you can take it and you can draw network and you can see that, some of the sort of, in this case, related classes of metabolites, they sort of cluster together. But it still resembles a hairball. There are a lot of these connections, okay? And so it turns out that Pearson's correlations do not allow, so you cannot differentiate between direct and indirect associations, right? That is, if you have four metabolites, A, B, C, and D, you cannot tell the difference here, whether A is connected to B and B is connected to C and C is connected to D, as opposed to A being connected directly to A, B, C, and D. It will just draw all these connections for you, okay? There is a statistical, there is a different statistical approach, which is called partial correlations, which allows you to account for the essentially influences of these other metabolites, and which allows you to differentiate between these direct and indirect associations. Okay, and here is the result of what you can do, and this is from a paper that was published several years ago, and the data set that they looked at, actually, it's a group at the Helmholtz Center in Munich, Germany, and they had a very large population study that had over 1,000 samples. Okay, and they've measured some lipid metabolites and amino acids using targeted, it's a Biocritis platform, and data are incredibly high quality and virtually no noise, excellent data set. Okay, and so in this situation, what they had essentially, they had a lot more samples than they had metabolites. Usually, it's a reverse situation, right? So more often than not, you're going to see a data set in which you will have fewer samples than metabolites, and you have these thousands of features and maybe at best few hundred samples. That's what is considered, in most cases, is considered a pretty large study, right? And so the approach that they published that uses Gaussian graphical modeling is very sensitive to that. So basically, mathematically, you cannot do that if you have to have more samples than metabolites, right? And so fortunately, George and his then graduate student, Samantha Basu, worked on a method and developed a method that allows you to deal with the situation that when you have fewer samples than metabolites. And if you're interested, I'm sure you know you can talk to George and he can tell you more about how it works. But essentially, then the way I understand it, the underlying idea is that we expect this network of metabolites to be sparse. We don't expect every connection to be there. And if you assume this sparsity, you can use a different modeling technique, which is called graphical lasso, and it can be applied to essentially, you know, do the modeling in situations where the number of samples is less than number of metabolites, and this sort of validation and sort of, you know, shows the performance of this DG lasso technique compared to the partial correlation that I showed you earlier. It's essentially the same network that you have seen before, but what we're doing here, so it's, you know, this German group, they were kind enough to share their data, published data set with us. So we, you know, looked here, Samantha looked at, you know, reconstructed network using the entire data set, 1,020 samples. And we're comparing two methods here. So we, you know, he selected a random subset of samples, decreasing the sample size. And when you got down to approximately 200 samples, this method hardly can recover any significant edges, whereas DG lasso still sort of, you know, can reconstruct some networks. So we were excited about that. And and we decided, okay, well, you know, with this we can do something practical. So we basically developed a program, that is Java. Essentially, it's a Java wrapper that allows you to upload your data and run this algorithm. Okay, and you're going to see a demo of that tomorrow. So this sort of shows the workflow, this tool, which we call a correlation calculator. It can do some very basic data normalization procedures. Optionally, I mean, you can normalize your data using any other technique. And in fact, we recommend that you actually, you know, don't just limit yourself to these simple ways. And most importantly, make sure that the data are normalized. Okay, and then if you have a large data set, the best thing to do is really to run Pearson's correlation first, and this is what is illustrated by this heat map here. And then there is a, you know, slider that allows you to set the threshold, which basically, you know, so I mean, basically, before you do partial correlation, if you select certain Pearson's threshold, I mean, these things here are more likely to have significant partial correlations. Anyway, and this sort of limits the computation and gives you more significant results. That's sort of, you know, we kind of empirically came up with this. And again, George can tell you more about sort of, you know, theoretical basis for doing it this way. And then you can run DG lasso. But, you know, the final step of that is, in fact, I'm going to, in the next slide, I'm just going to show you screenshots of that. And Bill and Marcy will show you the actual tool tomorrow live. You can basically, choose to send that directly to Medscape, and that's this new correlation module that I alluded to earlier, and it will build the correlation networks for you, okay? So again, I mean, the code is written in R, and the tool is Java-based. That's sort of, once first you sort of, load the tool, that's what it's going to look like. You can select, you can upload your file, and as I said, do data normalizations and choose to run Pearson's correlation. And once you have done that, that part sort of, here it's grayed out, it becomes active. You can sort of, filter by Pearson's correlation, and you can sort of, drag the slider. Then, you can proceed to do the, to calculate the partial correlation. One sort of, important sort of, feature here is you can click this button and it will sort of, draw the heat map for you. It is using R to do that. So in this case, as you, it's easy to see the labels because it's a very small heat map. If it's a large heat map, it may not be quite as useful, although it still provides an overview of the data. But you cannot see it here, but, Bill will mention it tomorrow. There is a way to essentially export your data, and you can view it in your favorite sort of, visualization program, such as CoolMap that Barbara mentioned, or there is another free program that is commonly used that is called Java Tree View that you can also, use to sort of, analyze your heat map. Okay? So if you're interested, come talk to me. I'll show you where to get it. All right, and so this is the correlation calculator tool. That's how you sort of, can display it, and that's, that will send it in, open it in Medscape. Okay, so I have a few more sort of, applications of that tool, but first sort of, I'm showing you two different amino acid networks. The network on the left is a correlation network. The compounds, the amino acids here are edges and the, nodes, and the edges between them are correlations, essentially, okay? And this network here is a pathway network, okay? I used all the same amino acids as compounds, and the two networks are not identical because, they're sort of, built using completely different mechanisms, but the message that I want to convey is that without any prior knowledge of the identity of these compounds, we can sort of, reconstruct this network, and they're all like, in close proximity, even though, we have absolutely no prior information as to, what these are, okay? Which means that it could work for unknown compounds as well. So if we can recover known networks in a sort of reasonable fashion, that means that we can recover the unknown networks as well, right? So, and this is the work that, Charles did helping us. This is just sort of, another application of this tool. So Maureen talked and, Charles and others talked about this issue with multiple in-source fragments and side peaks and so on and so forth, sort of, these redundant peaks. Turned out, which was a little unexpected, we didn't think about it when we were sort of, developing this tool. Turns out that with this program, you can sort of easily add another dimension, if you will. I mean, you can do a lot of work looking at the spectra and the retention times and sort of, trained person can identify this. But what we can do with this, we can easily pair them down, essentially, okay? Because if we see very strong correlation coefficients, I mean, it's really difficult, sometimes it's really difficult to believe that two different compounds can be that closely correlated, okay? And in many cases, like it is shown with proline here and valine, it turned out that, these very highly correlated fragments were in fact the same thing, right? This is another sort of, application for identification of unknown compounds where we sort of, recovered the networks where there were some known compounds and they were tightly clustered with unknown compounds. And in fact, Charles went ahead and did some experimental work to validate a couple of this pyroglutamic acid here. So, where, he was able to get the standards and in fact verify that, the unknown compounds are pyroglutamic acid and glutaryl carnitine here, and the last panel here shows the isotope distributions of that and so on, right? So, so this is from, Farsad's data in, subpenature. This is the sort of, lipid network that, comes from their data set. And so if you remember when I talked about the limitations of pathway mapping, I showed you the class level network that was built using pathway information. And this now is a correlation network where each lipid is sort of appropriately represented by individual node here. So just to sort of, give you an idea of where you can go with this and what the methods are. And so the last thing I want to mention about the sort of, applications of this, application of the methods that, new iteration of this that we're developing. I mean, the question still remains. I mean, I talked about these correlation networks, but I mean, the question that you might want to ask, so what do you do if you have two conditions, right? I mean, typically, what you're trying to do, you're comparing treatment versus control or disease versus healthy or whatever, right? So what if the network itself changes, right? You cannot assume that, the network will stay the same. And so this sort of, I mean, that's where the really interesting connections are, right? So we want to be able to identify the dysregulated metabolites, right? And so fortunately, George has developed, another method that is sort of, suitable for sort of, applying for this. And his student, Jing Ma, who recently graduated, that's her work as well. So what I'm showing you here is the network essentially where, I mean, you see that here I not only have differentially colored nodes, which represent up or down regulations of individual metabolites, but I have three different types of edges. So the black edges here are the edges that are common to both conditions, right? And green edges, so I mean, by the way, I mean, here I'm comparing diabetes versus healthy controls. The green edges are present in healthy controls, and red edges are the ones that we see in diabetes. And in fact, so, we're looking at sort of, differential regulation here, okay? So, and this last bit that I just showed you here is something that is currently under development. This is sort of, we're still testing it and trying to sort of, figure out appropriate parameters. But the rest of the tools that I talked about are all available. And if you go to our website, you can, download or whatever, find the links to all this there. And we really like the feedback. I mean, there is one thing that we cannot do very well. I mean, we do the best we can to test our tools, but, it's nearly impossible to think of possible applications and, other things. So please, if you have any thoughts or questions or feedback, we love that. And we always appreciate hearing back from people. Thank you. Thank you.
That was very interesting. I guess the thing that makes me nervous about correlation, basing your networks on correlations, is how do you know whether you're right or not? I mean, you're basically, it's a description, but right. It doesn't necessarily have much mechanistic implications for me anyway.
Right. Well, we're hoping that that we can sort of the amino acid networks that I showed, right? So I mean, we intentionally did it on the known data set where we know all the connections. I mean, well, you're right, we don't know, right? But we're trying to kind of get into this sort of uncharted territory, right? And so right. I'm hoping that by showing that we can recover some of the known connections. Supposedly we can find relevant connections between correlated metabolites.
Well,
right?
Okay, so you touched on what I was thinking about, which is, and you mentioned that you can reconstruct some of the known networks. So if you take the most well-known metabolic pathway, take a very simple, well-known one, mm-hmm. how good does your method do with that? Is it perfect?
No, it isn't. And I don't think it can be because, I mean, okay, well, you have to think about this, right? So the there are like a lot of different factors. The slide that I showed about data integration, I mean, you kind of have to think about all these layers, right? So I suppose if you have a system where, you know, you have like, you know, compound where you're running all these metabolic reactions, like, you know, in a test tube, I mean, where you can control, you know, influx and, you know, and so on and so forth and sort of, you know, metabolic rates and all of that. I mean, then you can sort of, you know, precisely measure that, right? But, I mean, there are all these different sort of layers of regulations that, you know, we have no idea about. And, I mean, you have to take into consideration flux, right? So we measure static levels of metabolites, right? So if they're not, if something hasn't changed, it doesn't mean that, you know, but I mean, the hope is that the, you know, things are sort of, you know, correlated. If they change in coordinated fashion, they are somehow functionally related, and we see some evidence, right? So, I mean, some things make sense to us, such as branched chain amino acids, right? So we know that, you know, leucine, isoleucine, valine are correlated, right? Some things we can explain, some things we cannot as easily explain, but perhaps they, you know, makes sense, right? But at least what it allows you to do, I mean, from a standpoint, like, you know, if you think about it, like in the context of unknown compounds, we hope that it can sort of, you know, prioritize this list of unknowns for sort of follow up, right? And narrow down the search space, right? So, I mean, I think we're still in the dark. I'll agree with you if that's what,
well,
you know.
Suppose you take glycolysis, for instance.
Right.
And you, is there a way, I'm sure some of these databases have the reactions of glycolysis
yeah.
in them, correct?
Yeah.
So can they actually take the molar amounts that you calculate from the, your data and actually plug them in and say, okay, are all the molar amounts fit with what we know about this pathway? Or do they just say, well, you know, fructose 1,6-bisphosphate is here and glucose 6-phosphate is here? Or does it say there's this much of this and therefore there has to be this much of that? I mean, of course, that gets into the reaction rates, which you can't
right.
measure.
Right. So it's a difficult thing to do. I mean, I can tell you that there is no direct correspondence between correlations and metabolic pathways. And this has been shown many times. There is no direct correspondence, right? But this is what the data tells us, as opposed to, I mean, and one thing that probably didn't, you know, come very clear in this is that, when, I mean, since we're doing it all in Medscape, all the pathway information for the known compounds is still there, right? So you can still look at sort of, you know, if you have enough coverage, you still can look at the pathway. So it's all still there. So we're just sort of, you know, by doing this sort of, you know, all this sort of, you know, playing this sort of tricks with the software, we're trying to kind of place that information at your fingertips, if you will, right?
So,
right. Well, it is a problem. It is a problem. And, right? So, I mean, one thing I can tell you, though, Liz, one thing that I can tell you is that from whatever limited amount of data we have seen, some of the correlations appear to be pretty stable. Okay? So, and, you know, in fact, a lot of them appear to be pretty stable. And sort of, you know, full disclosure, there are not a whole lot of large data sets out there yet. So there are you know, and there, you know, there's precious little to sort of, you know, see, but some of these appear to be pretty stable. So I think that, you know, I mean, I'm looking forward to sort of, you know, learning more about how this can be used. So we're just sort of, you know, but we're putting it out there. So, you know, we hope that you can, you know, prove or disprove whether it's, you know, useful or not. I guess, you know, time will tell. So, yeah.
So I'm not sure I understood correctly, but you said that there's overlapping peak, then somehow those peaks are two substrates that are in neighbors. So it, you have peaks and you helped Charles to identify that two substrate in the same peak. That happens because that two molecules have the same molecular weight or because they
are... No, these were standards, right, Charles?
Okay.
Going to buy your standard rather than looking at the list of 10 database hits that it could be and buying all 10 of them, you buy the one of them that looks like it's chemically connected, and then we took the sample, we ran it, then we ran it spiked with a little bit more of standard, and
okay.
So the peak went up, and that you know right there on the same retention time.
So kind of my question is,
the ID.
Is there any? Okay. So. Metabolites always separated. My question is there any possibility that the metabolites kind of stuck together and run together and you see the peak together?
There is some circumstance you might potentially envision where, and it does happen, where two peaks can be right on top of each other. But the odds that you know they're going to be chemically correlated with the same isotope distribution, the exact same mass and
okay.
Exact
So usually if you see the single peak, it should be only one molecule, not like a aggregate of molecule or something.
I can't hear you. Like if you had, say, let's say, you know, fructose 6-phosphate and glucose 6-phosphate on some methods, not all, some we can resolve them well, those have exactly the same mass. You can separate them on some method.
Okay. So kind of, so my question is more like, let's say in protein, we see talk about the protein-protein interaction, right? So is there any metabolite-to-metabolite interaction, some like a protein is kind of working as a binding factor and having metabolites together, and if, even if you, after the separation, you see those things come together?
No, I don't know about that so much, about things that actually chemically stick together. You know, generally,
no, that small, never happens.
Small molecules.
But if you have an enzyme...
So...
Not talking about in the mass spec, we're talking about in the biology.
Right.
Not much is known about that. Don't want to say it doesn't happen, but I don't
yeah. So I just want to say that I think in the interest of time, we should probably, you know, move ahead. And I will be around, and we're doing a demo, and many of you signed up for that. So I'll be happy to talk to you and answer any questions.